Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. As ever, if a member is looking to ask a supplementary question, I'd invite them to do so. Press their request to speak buttons during the relevant question. There's a fair bit of interest, so the usual plea for brevity in questions and responses. And I call question number one, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government when the nationwide programme of inspection to assess the condition of and impact of climate change on some of Scotland's most significant heritage sites being undertaken by Historic Environment Scotland is expected to be completed.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The inspection programme continues to progress well. Tactile inspections have been carried out at 30 sites across Scotland since last May. Historic Environment Scotland has been able to reopen a number of sites in Clare Baker's region, including Duncastle, Burley Castle and Inchcombe Abbey. And there is full or partial access to over 80% of the properties in care. And Historic Environment Scotland continues to assess the potential to reopen sites as soon as it is safe to do so, which I will continue to urge them to do as quickly as possible.
Claire Baker.
While, of course, the safety of sites is paramount, it is unfortunate that the progress has been made quicker. The inspection programme has now moved on to level two sites. That does include Aberdare Castle in my region, which I was pleased to visit recently and met with Hess. In 2019, there was over 24,000 visitors to that castle. So I know that the Minister recognises the impact on local businesses, and Aberdare does have much to offer, but part of its attraction is the importance of the castle, particularly for international visitors. So I'm wondering if the Government is making any assessment of what additional support towns and villages such as Aberdare will need during this prolonged period of closure.
Minister.
I can attest to my own family's relationship with Aberdour. My children love Aberdour Beach, but Aberdour Castle, the site is partially open. The walled gardens and driveway were made accessible in October last year. The inspection was completed in November and work is ongoing to reopen the internal areas with some restrictions, and the date is to be confirmed with that. But I'd be happy to either meet Claire Baker myself or indeed ensure that Historic Environment Scotland are able to meet with Claire Baker as well, because she's absolutely right. The importance of these sites as anchor organisations for local communities is well known, and I want to make sure that she's aware of the progress that has been made.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Fiona Hislop.
Last week, Historic Environment Scotland's Chief Executive informed a packed meeting organised by Linlithgow Civic Trust that Linlithgow Palace is to partially reopen in May following necessary works. This is very welcome news, but bearing in mind the damage to the north range of Linlithgow Palace and indeed many other properties still facing significant and continuing damage from the elements, will the Minister consider a new and comprehensive ruins management strategy to ensure that our much loved and valued ruined heritage can be managed into the future?
Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Fiona Hislop for that question. I'm pleased that she was able to have such a successful meeting with our local community and Historic Environment Scotland, which was able to give good news. And like her, I welcome the partial reopening of Linlithgow Palace coming in May and the work being undertaken by Historic Environment Scotland inspecting and repairing other properties in care as well. The properties in care represent some of Scotland's most iconic and culturally significant assets, including Linlithgow Palace. And we recently consulted more broadly on a refreshed strategy for Scotland's historic environment, which seeks to prioritise activities such as that suggested by Fiona Hislop that supports economic recovery and renewal. And this strategy focuses on creating a more resilient and sustainable historic environment and helps to communicate the contribution that a historic environment makes to our nation.
Thanks, Sharon Berry.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The core conservation costs for properties in Clare and Care in 2021-22 were £7.7 million. This represents a 14% reduction from 2017-18. The decline in the provision has been a consistent trend over the past 5 years. So given the impact of closed heritage sites on tourism and the local economy, can the Minister tell me what discussions he's had with HES to ensure that funding for conservation and maintenance is maintained, if not increased, to ensure no more sites close and those that already are reopen as quickly as possible.
I thank Sharon Dowd for that question. Obviously, Historic Environment Scotland have their own decisions to make. I obviously meet with them regularly about their strategic priorities, as I've already outlined to previous questioners. The Scottish Government has substantially increased resources to Historic Environment Scotland in recognition of the impact, not just of the pandemic on HES's commercial income, but also in terms of the need to ensure that our properties in care are maintained. Over 22-23, we will support Historic Environment Scotland with £68.6 million to maintain Scotland's heritage and historic environment, an 80% increase on pre-pandemic levels of funding. HES are working hard to reopen our heritage sites as soon as it is safe to do so, and we continue to support them in that endeavour.
Thank you. Question two is withdrawn. Question three, Claire Adamson, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any engagement it has had with the UK Government regarding the potential impact in Scotland of the ongoing negotiations over the Northern Ireland Protocol Bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I welcome the progress announced this week on the Northern Ireland Protocol. The Scottish Government consistently called for the UK Government to withdraw its irresponsible Northern Ireland Protocol Bill and to seek a sustainable negotiated solution to this entirely avoidable and deeply damaging dispute with our European neighbours. However, Scotland is still left with Brexit and all of the damage that comes with it. I urge the UK Government now to seize this opportunity to start the overdue work of repairing relations with our EU partners more widely and rebuilding closer cooperation and partnership across the many areas in which Scotland's interests have been harmed by Brexit. In addition, the UK Government must now clarify the policy on Northern Ireland to GB trade. This will be crucial to understand the impact on devolved responsibilities, including any physical checks on food safety and animal and plant health, and any associated infrastructure required, such as the border control post at Cairn Ryan.
Claire Adamson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. And it all being well, and this goes through, we look forward to a return to Horizon funding. However, can it be right that Scotland, which voted overwhelmingly to remain within the EU, has been ignored and is feeling the full force of a hard Brexit, while Mr Sunak shamelessly boasts about the huge economic benefits that access to the EU single market will bring for Northern Ireland?
Cabinet Secretary.
We've repeatedly called for the UK Government to find a negotiated solution to this entirely avoidable dispute with the European Union. The Scottish Government unequivocally supports the Good Friday Agreement, and we welcome the new agreement that has been announced on the Northern Ireland Protocol. However, Scotland did not vote for Brexit, and yet we continue to suffer from the consequences, including exacerbating the current cost of living crisis. While Northern Ireland has been given preferential access to the huge European single market, Scotland, which voted overwhelmingly to remain in the EU, has been ignored by the UK Government and subjected to the full damage of disastrous hard Brexit. The Scottish Government is now carefully considering the deal and what it means for Scotland. Brexit has brought nothing but harm to people, to communities and businesses in Scotland, and the Scottish Government remains committed to realising Scotland's potential as an independent nation within the European Union.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Willie Rennie.
For decades, the troubles in Ireland have cost lives, ruined families and destroyed communities. It has required delicate, pragmatic, exhausting engagement and diplomacy by great leaders over many, many years. So forgive me if I get a little bit exasperated by politicians here who seek to exploit the developments in Northern Ireland to advance their own narrow agenda. Will the First Minister, and actually will the Minister here, think again about drawing parallels between Northern Ireland and our Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't think we've got enough time to do the question, justice. As we've learned from the developments this week, it would have been perfectly possible to reach an agreement in principle before, but that was impossible given the confrontational approach of the last UK Prime Minister, notwithstanding his claim that he had an oven-ready deal. I think it behoves all of us to understand that what will now happen with Northern Ireland remaining within the single European market is that Northern Ireland will have a competitive advantage relative to Scotland and to Scottish businesses. That's a statement of fact. I don't know if Willie Rennie disagrees with that. And regardless of where we stand on the question of whether Scotland should be a sovereign member state of the European Union, it is going to become ever more apparent that Northern Ireland is in an exceptionally privileged position, one that the Prime Minister himself described as being so, and Scotland being as a disadvantage. So I would hope that the Liberal Democrats and the fellow parties which at one stage supported membership of the European Union but are now supporting Brexit, to think again and to stand up for Scotland's social, economic and political interests, at least for this.
And briefly, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary has already mentioned harm. And does he agree that the renegotiated NI protocol could have a harmful impact on Scottish businesses that no longer have access to the EU market, as we've said already, while Northern Ireland businesses enjoy those benefits?
And as briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, I've already put on record, I think it's a good thing that Northern Ireland is able to remain within the single European market. It's something that the Scottish Government has supported, whilst at the same time saying, well, Scotland voted to remain in the European Union, and if it's possible to find an arrangement for part of the United Kingdom to remain within the single European market, then surely it must be possible for another, namely Scotland. Now, unfortunately, the UK Government chose to ignore that. It would have been entirely possible to do so. So now we find ourselves in a situation where, notwithstanding the fact that we think it is a good thing that a solution has been found for Northern Ireland, is recognising that Scotland not having that status within the single European market puts Scotland at a competitive disadvantage when it comes to inward investment, when it comes to our exporting industries. Surely that should be obvious to everybody in this chamber, and no doubt we will be coming back to it over the months and the years ahead.
Question 4, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support the work of Systema Scotland.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Systema Scotland is a brilliant example of how lives can be changed and enriched through culture. Its work contributes to many Scottish Government policies outcomes, in particular our ambitions to tackle child poverty. The Scottish Government has supported Systema Scotland with annual funding since 2012, providing £1.1 million in 2022-23. In addition, we have established a cross-portfolio reference group for Systema Scotland to understand where their excellent work aligns with priorities across government, and the group's next meeting is due to take place in the spring.
Michael Meyer.
Thank the Minister for that answer and for that support for this vital organisation. But last week, the SNP on Dundee City Council cut all financial support for Systema Scotland's Big Noise Douglas. And right now, the SNP Council in Aberdeen City are cutting all funding. Vital, effective support proven by research by the Glasgow Centre for Population Health for 1,250 of the most disadvantaged children in Scotland swept away. Yesterday, Presiding Officer, the world-renowned Gustavo Dudamel of the Los Angeles Philharmonic said these programmes in Scotland have been an inspiration to the world and planted seeds with millions of children everywhere. What will the government do now? Will they be true to their own words? Will it be culture only for the privileged few? We know this works. Will you step forward where other SNP members have failed?
Minister.
Thank you very much indeed. So we're already engaging with Systema Scotland. Indeed, the Deputy First Minister met with them only a few weeks ago around how we can continue to support the work that they do. Obviously, we're aware of the proposed and decisions that have been taken at local authority level, which are concerning given the value of the work Systema Scotland does in local authorities across Scotland, and we're working closely with the organisation to showcase the impact of their work. I must emphasise, though, local authorities are accountable to the public who elect them, and they have the financial freedom to operate independently, taking account of local needs, which I know as a former councillor, Michael Mara will understand and agree with. And so we'll continue to work with Systema, we'll continue to work with our local authority partners, who we are providing nearly £13.5 billion to through the local government settlement in 23-24. However, councils are autonomous. It's their responsibility to agree budgets, considering their statutory duties, local and national priorities.
And brief supplementary, Douglas Lawson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I share the Minister's views on Systema and the good work it does within our communities. And that's why I'm absolutely disgusted with the SNP Lib Dem administration at Aberdeen City Council axing the budget for Big Noise Tory. summing a budget I protected when I was council leader for 4 years. So will he now intervene to find a way to save Big Noise Tory?
Minister. I don't think on this, you know, this is an issue that is for our local authorities to determine, and I don't think it is for MSPs or government ministers to intervene on local government decisions. I think that is a general principle that most of us normally ascribe to. So we'll continue to work with Sistema, we'll continue to work with our local government partners to ensure that we are continuing to provide services that ensure that people continue to enjoy cultural experiences, and children in particular are able to enjoy the types of offerings that are provided by the likes of Sistema to lift them out of poverty, to ensure that they have aspiration to continue to contribute through culture, and I'll ensure that those issues are continued to be reported in the work that we do.
Question number 5, not lodged. Question number 6, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what gender-specific risk and safety planning is carried out to support Ukrainian refugees at the point of arrival in Scotland, as well as in the medium and long term.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Ruth Maguire can be assured that ensuring the well-being and safety of Ukrainian people through early identification of risk and need is central to our response and has been from the very outset of our programme. Our welcome hubs conduct trauma-informed initial assessments to identify any immediate welfare or protection concerns, and this includes gender-specific risks. Ongoing support is tailored based on the needs of the individual and is delivered locally, and the Scottish Government is working with various safeguarding partners to inform our approach linked to Equally Safe, our strategy to prevent and eradicate violence against women and girls.
Ms. Maguire.
I'm grateful to the Minister for that answer. We know that once it happens, it's very difficult to recover victims of trafficking. The CPG on human trafficking last week heard from experts that some of the things that increased people's vulnerability, some of the risks were insecure accommodation, relationship breakdown and complacency from authorities. And in saying that, they were putting a challenge to all of us. Would the Minister agree with me that there is not only opportunity but imperative on us all to be awake to the threat and work together to prevent this heinous crime before it happens?
Minister.
I 100% agree with Ruth Maguire there. Guidance for practitioners involved in safeguarding people arriving from Ukraine to identify and respond to risk and need. It has been published and is regularly reviewed, and we are providing £622,000 to the Trafficking Awareness Raising Alliance in 2022-23 to support adult females trafficked for the purpose of commercial sexual exploitation. This is in addition to over £2.5 million provided to Migrant Help during this financial year to support all other adult victims of human trafficking and exploitation in Scotland. Given her clear interest and long-standing work in this area, I'd be more than happy to meet with Ruth Maguire to talk about this in more detail.
And brief supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Cerida Scotland recently launched their report on sexual and gender-based violence amongst refugees in Scotland. The report highlighted that urgent need for service in Scotland to focus on forced migrant survivors of sexual and gender-based violence, including a dedicated working group to address specific needs of survivors. Given the continued influx of refugees currently coming to Scotland from Ukraine, will the Minister advise what action the Scottish Government will take to consider the recommendation of this report?
Minister.
I'd be more than happy to continue to consider that. We, in addition to the funding that I spoke about in answer to Ruth Maguire's question, the £622,000 for trafficking awareness and £2.5 million provided to Migrant Help, we're also funding and working directly with the Scottish Refugee Council. They provide initial support and are also helping us ensure that from a policy perspective we're responding in the most effective way. But I'd be more than happy to consider what Faisal Chowdhury has raised and thank him for his support and work in this area.
Question 7, Fiona Hislop.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is ensuring that Scotland keeps as aligned as possible with European policy developments.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to remaining close to the European Union and to building the strongest possible relationship between the EU and Scotland. Our alignment policy protects the well-being of people of Scotland by maintaining and advancing the standards that we share with the EU wherever it's practical and possible to do that under the current constitutional settlement. This policy was approved by this Parliament in June 2022 and is being delivered through evidence-based policymaking and stakeholder engagement. Our alignment policy helps realise the vision we share for the continent's future and its part in the world, from ensuring our people's prosperity to tackling the climate emergency and supporting the people of Ukraine, and helps to pave the way for an independent Scotland's return to the European Union in the future.
Fiona Hislop.
Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that this work is properly resourced in order that Scotland, given the opportunity, can join the European Union as seamlessly as possible? And with all the UK political parties, Conservative, Labour and Liberal Democrats, embracing Brexit with no intention of rejoining the EU, can he confirm that the only road to joining the European Union goes through independence for Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, and the Scottish Government's approach focuses on maintaining and advancing the high standards that we share with the European Union where that is possible, and its consideration is integral to our approach to evidence-based policymaking across the full range of devolved policy areas. At the same time, the UK Government's retained EU law bill threatens these high standards and undermines devolution, which is why this Parliament has agreed not to give consent to that bill. The Member also references other parties' policies in relation to the EU. Labour, of course, doesn't just now support Brexit, it supports the hard Brexit negotiated by Boris Johnson, which keeps Scotland and the UK out of the huge European Single Market and Customs Union, despite all of the economic damage that it is causing.
And brief supplementary from Sarah Boyack, who joins us online.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It will come as no surprise to the Cabinet Secretary that I'm wanting to raise transparency. I have raised this issue before. It's about the ability of MSPs to scrutinise the Scottish Government on where it does decide to keep pace with EU legislation and where it doesn't. It's severely constrained due to the lack of information. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm whether the Scottish Government is still considering the SEAC Committee's proposal for a memorandum of understanding between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to provide information and scrutiny on the Government's approach to keeping pace with key pieces of EU legislation?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
I'm happy to confirm to Sarah Boyack that our officials are continuing to work with parliamentary officials on the question of European Union alignment. It's not just with the historic issues, but it's also with the forthcoming challenge of the retained European Union law process that we're going to have to go to. I'm absolutely seized of this matter. This will be, no doubt, a subject that Sarah Boyack and others in the Chamber will wish to be reassured on, and I am happy to again give the commitment to her that I want us to have the best transparency in place as we go forward, making sure that members understand the ways in which the Scottish Government intends for us to remain aligned with European Union law.
Question number 8, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of its contributions to development in Malawi through its Malawi Development Programme 2018-23.
Mr Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government committed £11.4 million for the current programme for projects that contribute to the achievement of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. For example, our project establishing Malawi's first dental school, which now has more students enrolled than registered dentists in Malawi, with 50% of the latest intake now female. We require 6 monthly progress reports before any grant payments are made, and these allow for ongoing assessment of each project's contribution to development in Malawi. Grant holders are also required to provide an end project report with details of the project's achievements and any lessons learned.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Minister for his answer. I think we would all agree in the Chamber that the partnership between Malawi and Scotland remains important now, perhaps more than ever, as both countries face immense global challenges. How is, therefore, the Scottish Government ensuring continued support for Malawi and other partner countries like Rwanda and Zambia beyond March 2023?
Minister.
I thank Christine Graham for that question. It allows me to re-emphasise the importance and how proud I am of the incredible and durable relationship that there is between Scotland and Malawi, and the incredible work that is done by our partners, including the Malawi-Scotland Partnership and the Scotland-Malawi Partnership, in ensuring that that can be continued and sustained. We are currently working on the design design of our new programmes to implement the outcomes of our international development review. And whilst that programming is underway, I've taken the decision to extend our existing cohort of projects until March 2024. This additional spend on these programmes will help ensure the Scottish Government continues to support our partner countries whilst ensuring we utilise our International Development Fund in an efficient and effective manner. And across our whole programme, the Scottish Government remains in close contact with our partners in Malawi, Rwanda and Zambia and are aware of the immense challenges in these partner countries and continue to respond to those as we can.
And very brief supplementary, Alexander.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. NHS Tayside developed the Scottish Emergency Medicine Malawi project with the aim of delivering Malawi a national emergency and trauma network. Can I ask the Minister what progress has been made on this project to date?
Minister, briefly.
I hope the correspondence that I sent back to Mr Stewart will be of assistance in this regard. We are under the process, as I've already said, of reviewing and restarting some of our programmes where there's an opportunity for groups and bids to be brought forward, and I'll be happy to continue to work with Mr Stewart and others who are looking to be part of that.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next portfolio question. Okay, and the next portfolio is Justice and Veterans. Again, if a member wishes to ask a supplementary, I'd invite them to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. We've got quite a bit of interest again in this section, so brief questions and responses, please. And I call question number one, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the progress being made to ensure that domestic abuse legislation better reflects victims' experiences.
Minister Eleanor Whittam.
We must treat domestic abuse survivors with compassion and availability of services which acknowledge the significant trauma they have experienced. Our Victim Centre Approach Fund has awarded £48 million to provide support to victims, including £18.5 million for specialist advocacy support for survivors of gender-based violence. Research on the operation of our groundbreaking domestic abuse legislation found that it does better reflect victims' experiences. I am acutely aware, however, that more needs to be done, and I am committed to working with our partners across the justice system to do so, including through legislative reform and rolling out of trauma-informed practice.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Minister for her answer. I too welcome the findings of the recent interim report into the groundbreaking domestic abuse legislation, which highlights the beneficial impact of including emotional and psychological abuse in this area of the law. Can the Minister outline how the measures in the 2023-24 budget will support the ongoing work to ensure that victims' rights and needs are at the centre of Scotland's criminal justice system going forward?
Minister.
We are strengthening how justice and wider public services support victims through our budget. This includes continuation of support to more than 20 organisations through the Victim-Centred Approach Fund and support to victims of violent crime in Scotland through the Criminal Injuries Compensation Scheme. And as part of our vision for justice and the commitment to support victims in their journey to healing and recovery, we must offer approaches in justice which place victims at the heart. A Victims Advisory Board has been established by the Victims Task Force to ensure victims' experiences are directly informing our action and the actions of our justice partners. And I know Jackie Dunbar will welcome the establishment of the Women's Justice Leadership Panel, which I chair, which is looking at how we address gender inequality and improve women's experiences within the justice system.
And supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the ways we can legislate to crack down on domestic abuse is to crack down on forced marriages involving young people. The Minister will be aware of steps taken in England and Wales to raise the age of consent of marriage to 18. Can I ask if the Scottish Government plans to do the same?
Minister.
This is something that the Scottish Government is actively looking at.
For the supplementary, Polly McNeill.
Thank you. A report published by the Scottish Government this month looked into the experience of families who have fallen victim to domestic abuse. Female victims of domestic abuse told interviewers of their harrowing experiences in the courtroom, with their abusers exhibiting intimidating and threatening behaviour towards them before and during the trial. In one case that I know of, a complainer of rape alleges that her abuser, solicitor, turned to the galleries, and pointed at her during sentencing. So does the Minister believe that there should be clear protocols for behaviour within courtrooms as well that should be enforced, and clear ways of being able to complain about any incidents?
Minister.
In 2021, we, in consultation with the Victims Task Force, commissioned NHS Education for Scotland to create a knowledge and skills framework specifically to support the development of a trauma-informed workforce in the justice sector. The framework was endorsed by the Victims Task Force on a meeting of the 7th of December 2022. So this is something that we are acutely aware of. Thank you.
And a further supplementary, Fiona Hislop.
A number of my constituents have advised me that their abusive ex-partners were able to continue to abuse them in ways that were difficult to evidence in court, despite the robust legislation in place. For example, by using child contact arrangements to exert control over their ex-partner. Can the Minister advise me of what action can be taken to increase understanding across the justice system of the often insidious nature, as we've just heard, of abuse, to ensure that even less obvious examples of abuse are recognised as such?
And Minister.
I fully appreciate the need to ensure abuse is recognised across the justice system in both criminal and civil cases. In relation to child contact cases, the legislation requires the court to have regard to abuse and the risk of abuse. The Scottish Government is committed to preparing a discussion paper on the interaction between criminal and civil cases. A key part of that work will be to consider how all forms of abuse can be tackled to prevent the situations as clearly narrated by Fiona Hislop.
And question two, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to tackle cybercrime.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government works closely with national and with UK partners, including Police Scotland, the National Cyber Security Centre and the Cyber and Fraud Centre Scotland, to tackle fraud and cybercrime and to reduce the harm it inflicts upon communities in Scotland. There's a range of advice to help people improve their online safety found on cyberscotland.com, as well as from the National Cyber Security Centre, CyberAware, Take 5 and Get Safe. Victims of any crime should phone Police Scotland. And finally, I would highlight to the Chamber that currently Cyber Scotland Week, which I opened at the Future Scots Cyber Security Conference on Monday, is ongoing. There are over 100 events taking place across the country, raising awareness of being safe and secure online and promoting cyber security careers.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that fulsome response. In recent years, there has been a huge shift in small firms moving their business online. Yet BT research shows that thousands of Scotland's small firms could be open to cyber attack because of little or no business-grade cyber security in place, and almost half suffered cyber breaches last year. What measures are in place specifically to help our small businesses, and are there plans to step up the share of police resources dedicated to tackling cybercrime?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's a very important point that Kenny Gibson raises, not least because the nature of some of the cyber crimes, in particular ransomware and so on, has now shown that smaller and smaller companies have been attacked, whereas in the past it tended to be larger companies. But for the part of the Scottish Government, we funded Cyber Scotland, Partner Scotland IS, to engage and support the Scottish IT managed services sector, as many small businesses rely on them for their security. We also support another partner, the Cyber and Fraud Centre Scotland, previously SBRC, to host the Cyber Incident Response Helpline, which aims at offering first-line incident support to small businesses. The allocation of other resources is a matter for Police Scotland. However, despite UK government austerity, the Scottish Government has increased police funding year on year since 2016-17, and in 23-24, the service will receive additional resource funding of £80 million, a 6.3% increase.
And supplementary, Russell Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. The National Crime Agency estimates that up to 850,000 people in the UK pose a sexual threat to children, which is a truly horrifying and terrifying statistic. Now, 2 years ago, Police Scotland's award-winning Get Help or Get Caught campaign targeted those who might seek to groom children online or in real life. Now, given the constant online threat to children, can the Cabinet Secretary tell me whether there are any similar measures or initiatives that his government might be taking?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, in the general area, we work very closely with the UK government and have done so in terms of their online crime bill, number of which provisions of which relate to exactly the kind of crimes which Russell Finlay is talking about. So we do that with them. It's best, of course, that we work together on areas where the border, there's no borders online, it's not an effective mechanism to stop these crimes. So we do that in conjunction with the UK and with other partners. The Scottish Police Authority as well, through the Serious Organised Crime Group, look at a number of ways in which children, not just in terms of sexual abuse, but in terms of human trafficking, can be victims through online activities. So there's a great deal of work ongoing. I'm happy to provide further information on other initiatives to Russell Finlay in writing.
Question number 3 is not lodged. Question 4 from Natalie Dawn, who joins us online.
To ask the Scottish Government how the Victim Surcharge Fund is aiming to support women who are victims of domestic abuse.
Minister Eleanor Wood.
The Victim Surcharge Fund has opened 3 times to applications from organisations that provide support to victims of crime. So far, 11 organisations, including Victim Support Scotland, Dumbarton District Women's Aid, Edinburgh Women's Aid and Angus Women's Aid, have shared more than £917,000 grant funding to provide practical help directly to victims, including victims of domestic abuse. Examples of support provided by the fund include meeting clothing and other essential expenses for those escaping domestic abuse and the installation of alarm and video systems to help victims feel safe.
Natalie Dawn.
I'd like to thank the Minister for that answer. The trauma and fear that victims of domestic abuse suffer is incomprehensible for many, and the support required can vary. We have a whole range of organisations in Scotland, the Minister's named a few, who play a vital role in supporting women through the most difficult of circumstances. Renfrewshire's Women's Aid, who operate in my constituency, offer tailored support to women who are experiencing domestic abuse. However, I note that they did not receive funding from the Victim Surcharge Fund. Can I ask the Minister if and when there will be a fourth round of this funding, and what other funding opportunities that are for organisations providing support for victims of domestic abuse?
Minister.
The Victim Surcharge Fund will open to more applications once sufficient money has been collected, and we anticipate that this will be towards the end of this year. So far, all organisations offering support to domestic abuse survivors that have applied have received funding. In the meantime, organisations supporting victims of domestic abuse that have not applied to the Victim Surcharge Fund can approach Victim Support Scotland on behalf of those they are supporting for help, as Victim Support Scotland manage an emergency assistance fund, partially funded through the Victim Support Surcharge Fund. And I would encourage Natalie Dawn and indeed all MSPs to make sure that this is well known.
A couple of brief supplementaries. Firstly, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the context of increasing anti-immigrant sentiment in some parts of Scotland, can I ask the Minister what signposting and support is available to women survivors of domestic abuse who have no recourse to public funds?
Minister.
Like myself, I know Maggie Chapman has a keen interest in this area, and the Scottish Government is clear that women with no recourse to public funds should be offered the same level of support as other women in Scotland and not face disadvantage. We continue to urge the UK Government to ensure all victims of domestic abuse are afforded the same protections and support. Our Ending Destitution Together strategy presses the UK Government to extend the Destitution Domestic Violence Concession to make it available to anyone who is in the UK as a dependent on someone else's visa or protection status, regardless of the timescales of that status. And we will continue to make the case in the strongest of terms going forward.
And briefly, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ensure the fund is fully utilised, will the Scottish Government make sure that it's available and well communicated across rural Scotland and island areas for the benefit of all women who are victims of domestic abuse?
Prime Minister.
Absolutely. I can give Beatrice Wishart the assurance that we will seek to make sure it's communicated effectively.
Thank you. Question 5, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether all victims of crime are given notice in advance of their case going to court.
Lord Advocate.
Thank you. The Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014 provides that all victims of crime with the right to request and obtain information about their case. This includes information on the stage that any criminal proceedings have reached. In relation to victims in our most serious cases, including sexual, domestic abuse, stalking and hate crimes, and also in relation to bereaved relatives who have lost a loved one through crime, the Crown provides notice without any request, so long as the individual victim or bereaved relative so wishes. I should make the point that the provision of information to victims was considered by this Parliament during the passage of the 2014 Act, and the enacted legislation reflects the decision of Parliament to enable victims to receive this information should they wish it.
Edward Mountain.
And I thank the Lord Advocate for that answer. I'm aware of examples in the Highlands where victims have not been notified in advance when the trial is going to court, sometimes reading the outcomes in the press. Can the Lord Advocate confirm whether this issue is widespread throughout Scotland? And if so, how many victims have not received advance notifications of trials in the last year?
Lord Advocate.
Thank you for the follow-up question. I should say to Mr. Mountain that before today, an inquiry was made of your office to ascertain if the question that was being posed today was prompted by any specific prosecution or any specific complaint. And I was advised that the question posed today was simply one of a generic nature. So what I would like to do is to request Mr. Mountain to contact the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service with the examples of the cases that he's given today, and I will look at these and follow up the specific cases that he wishes to raise. So that's the response I'm able to give today, only as a follow-up to the question posed. If there are specific cases where there's been no notification or there's been difficulty communicated to Mr. Mountain in his office, I'm more than happy to hear about that and to respond to that in specific detail.
Thank you. Question number six, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service capital budget for 2023-24 on the amount of maintenance work required in court buildings across the country.
Cabinet Secretary.
Prioritisation of maintenance work in Scotland's courts and tribunals is an operational matter for SCTS. Essential capital works are carried out on a priority basis, informed by an ongoing programme of condition surveys. The capital position is particularly challenging across a number of portfolios, including justice, but despite this, we have been able to increase the capital allocation to SCTS in 23-24 by £4.7 million towards known capital pressures, on top of the baseline £8 million annual capital allocation. Current levels of Scottish Government capital funding should ensure the programme of maintenance will continue.
Liam Kerr.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer, but the last time SCTS faced such difficult financial circumstances, it closed 10 sheriff courts, including Arbroath and Stonehaven in my region. Now, there's a £7.3 million maintenance backlog in our courts at the moment, and the spectre of 2013 is never far from the minds of those in local justice. So will the Cabinet Secretary provide them with the certainty they need and say there will be no more court closures in the lifetime of this Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, I think it's important to put some context in relation to what the member mentions of the 10 sheriff courts which were closed in 2015. It's worth pointing out that context necessarily includes what we receive from the UK government and what they spend on justice. The two are linked inextricably, and I'm sure the member will acknowledge that. So in England and Wales, for example, there were 239 courts. I don't know if this is uncomfortable to hear, but if you could do me the courtesy of listening to the answer to the question that you've asked, if it's possible.
Cabinet Secretary, you can resume your seat. We've had a good session so far where questions have been asked and responses have been provided. Can we continue in a similar vein, Mr. Kerr? Cabinet Secretary.
So 239 court closures in England and Wales since 2010 have closed. And with reference to the courts, this is a quote from the Bar Council. Crumbling court buildings are not fit for purpose, including leaks, infestations and lack of basic facilities. Now, the obvious link is what they spend on justice in England and Wales has a direct consequence for what they spend in Scotland. Despite that, in response to the point that was made by Mr. Kerr, we have no current plans to initiate further court closures in Scotland, despite the appalling funding from England and Wales and the UK Government.
Question number seven, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking in partnership with the Scottish Prison Service, NHS boards and others to support the health and wellbeing of people in prison and prevent deaths by suicide.
Cabinet Secretary.
We recognise that people in prison often present with higher levels of risk and vulnerability than the general population as a whole. We are committed to ensuring they can access healthcare that is, as a minimum, equal to that offered in the community. And we're working with the Scottish Prison Service and NHS boards to improve health outcomes for people living in our prisons, including to prevent deaths by suicide. The work is informed by the Scottish Government's Prison Healthcare Needs Assessments, the Mental Welfare Commission's report on prisoner mental health support, and the independent review of the response to deaths in prison custody. And across this work, we will embed the principles of time, space and compassion to ensure people are able to access high-quality, compassionate, appropriate and timely support, which supports wellbeing and recovery.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? According to the University of Glasgow report, there has been a 42% rise in lives lost to suicide in Scottish prisons since 2016. and last year's progress report on the independent review of the response to deaths in prison custody showed that the uptake of the review's recommendations has been disappointingly slow. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide reassurances that progress is being accelerated towards implementing all of the recommendations that were in that review?
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, just to say, first of all, that my thoughts are first and foremost with anyone who has lost a loved one in prison custody by suicide. Every death by suicide is a tragedy. We are committed to working with partners to implement the recommendations from the independent review into deaths in custody. While the progress report in December recognised that some of the issues are complex and will take some time to resolve and implement, further pace, as the member suggests, is needed. And following publication of the progress report, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care and I jointly wrote to the Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service and to all NHS Scotland Chief Executives and Integration Authorities, Chief Officers, requesting the greater priority be given to timely implementation of the recommendations. Julian Imrie, the former Chief Inspector of Constabulary, will continue in her role as the external chair of the review into late 2023, providing support and leadership to implement the recommendations, and a further update on progress will be published later this year.
Please supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst I understand that the SPS Suicide Prevention and Prison Strategy is currently under review, and I welcome the commitment to improve provisions for people who live in our prisons, can the Cabinet Secretary outline what steps are being taken ahead of the publication of the review to improve prisoner mental wellbeing?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Government, in partnership with its stakeholders, commissioned a comprehensive needs assessment of the prison population in relation to social care, substance use, mental health and physical health. And we are working with senior leaders from across Scottish Government, the Prison Service and NHS boards to provide additional oversight and to drive forward priority improvements. We are fully engaged with the SPS in the development of the Scottish Government's new mental health and wellbeing strategy. And the Scottish Government also sits on the SPS Mental Health and Wellbeing Steering Group. And this close working is informing our collective approach to improving wellbeing and suicide prevention in all of our prisons.
And briefly, Willie Rennie.
I mean, the Minister will have heard deep concern from all sides of the Chamber today about the high rates of suicide and also other deaths. Can he give us an indication about how quickly we're going to get this situation turned around? I've heard the detail of the answers he's provided, but when are we going to see some returns on this investment?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've mentioned in my original substantive answer that we expect a further update from the chair of the review later this year, but already a lot of these actions have been implemented. For example, simply making sure that people are told, the family are told immediately, was something that was not done routinely previously. That is being done by governors and their associates now. So these are being implemented now, but as I say, a further update will happen this year to give more information to the member and the chamber.
And question 8, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the outcome of its investigation into the provision of reconviction statistics for the 2019-20 offender cohort.
Cabinet Secretary.
As noted in the response to a previous parlementary question, that was S6W13874, the heavy impact of the pandemic and subsequent court closures on reconvictions data means that user needs for information must be balanced against the provision of meaningful and informative statistics that carry minimal risk of misinterpretation. The investigation into what information we could helpfully provide to users in respect of reconvictions stats is still ongoing, and we plan to communicate the outcome of this investigation by the end of March.
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but I'm sure he will agree that third sector run programmes offering pre- and post-discharge support to prisoners can play a hugely important role in reducing reoffending and improving outcomes more generally. Given that the funding for such projects relies on being able to demonstrate their effectiveness with empirical data, does he agree that it's vital data like reconviction statistics is gathered, validated and published in a reasonable timeframe?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's absolutely the case, as the member says. And I would just say that if we were to publish the data that we have, which would show a very substantial drop, as the member will appreciate, in the year after, which was the first year of lockdowns, for example, that would show probably quite a dramatic reduction, but it wouldn't be an accurate picture. There's more to it than that. And also, in order to give meaningful information, we have to do the investigation, which has been referred to, but we also have to make sure that the stats provided come up to a certain standard. They are at the gold standard now. They're accredited, they're vindicated, they're validated. We want to make sure that's the case. So there's no reason for not providing this information other than to make sure that it's accurate as possible, and that's what we intend to do.
And brief supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much welcome the crime statistics released this week, which show a fall in the number of crimes recorded by police last year. The Scottish Government's vision for justice aims to shift the balance from short-term sentences to community-based interventions, which we know are more effective at reducing reoffending. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how the Bail and Release Bill will help reduce reoffending, crime and future victimisation?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a really important question. The member will know, of course, as the chair of the committee, that the Bail and Release Bill will help to reduce reoffending and future victimisation by ensuring public safety and victim protection are at the heart of bail decision-making and improving support for people leaving prison custody. The bill recognises the negative impact that short periods of imprisonment can have, particularly for those who have not been convicted of a crime, and the evidence that community-based interventions can be more effective at supporting rehabilitation. So the bill supports the principle that those who do not pose a risk to public safety or in certain circumstances a risk to delivery of justice should be admitted to bail. Effective support for people leaving prison reduces their risk of reoffending, something which we all want to see, and that's why the bill includes reforms to improve pre-release planning and the support provided to individuals on release. The bill should be seen, though, alongside our ongoing investment in community-based alternatives to custody, as well as our continuing investment in third sector voluntary through care services across Scotland.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause while the front benches change before we move to the next item of business.